Welcome to the Chris McKee Podcast. I'm Chris McKee. On today's episode, we're going to talk a little bit more college basketball as per usual. And today's guest is Nate Oates, who is the head coach for the University of Buffalo. The Buffalo Bulls are one of the best kept secrets in all of college basketball. They're currently the number one team in the MAC conference, where they are 18-6 overall and 10-1 in conference play. And they look to be the favorite to win the MAC conference and make it in the NCAA tournament. Around Christmas time, they added a two-sport player, Dominic Johnson, who's a quarterback on the Buffalo football team, to the roster. And he's only played in six games as a backup, but it's still a pretty cool story. That happened just after I talked to Nate, so I didn't get the chance to talk to him about it, but it adds a little bit more intrigue to his team. We also touched on Nate's wife's battle with cancer, which he was very candid with. I mean, it's always a topic that, you know, I wasn't sure about discussing it with him, but he was very open with it. So I asked a few follow-up questions, and his wife appears to be doing very well these days, which is great news. And it also makes it really easy to root for Nate and Buffalo. But this is a pretty good team, Buffalo. They're set up for a good run this season, and next year they return just about every single key player. And Nate mentioned some of the key recruits they have coming in that he's excited about. But this is going to be a team to really watch out for over the next two or three years in college basketball, and especially come March. So thanks for tuning in. Don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel and drop me a line on Twitter at Mr. McKee, M-R-M-C-K-E-E. Let me know what you think. So here it is, my conversation with Nate Oates, the third-year head coach for the Buffalo Bulls in the NCAA. You're entering your third year as a head coach in Buffalo. What do you do better now that you didn't do 3 years ago, maybe?
Well, shoot, my first year, I was dealing with my wife's cancer and all that, so that was, I think I do a little bit better job preparing as the head coach. That was a hectic year, that first year. I've got Coach Weitzel still my associate coach. He does an unbelievable job with the scouts, and he did a really good job that year, just almost, you know, being an associate head coach, because I take a little time, you know, not, it's hard being at everything I needed to. So I think we do a better job with the game preps. I think I'll say the one big thing leading into this season, last off season and going into this season, we've spent a lot more time on, I don't know what you call it, you want to call it mental skills coaching, character coaching, like building, team building type stuff. I just think like everybody around the athletic department just kind of comments on how much better group of guys we've got. But they are a good group of kids, but we've spent a lot more time on some of that stuff that's not straight basketball. It's not straight X and O's. It's, you know, more individual meetings with the players, getting guys' minds right, that type of stuff. And I think, you know, I was a head coach in high school for 11 years, but in that regard, it was a little easier because I had all those kids in class almost like every day. Like, I taught all four grade levels. Like, I had math, I had a freshman course, a sophomore slash junior course, and then a junior slash senior course. So I pretty much had, like, all my players in class. You get to see them every day outside of the court. Like, here, you gotta schedule that stuff in a little bit more. Like, you don't bump into them. You don't get them for an hour outside of basketball. It was easier to do stuff off the floor with high school kids. So we made a concerted effort to have the team over for cookouts in the summer. Took them on the boat in the summer. Did more of that team building and leadership training and mental skills training and character building type stuff. So I think we're doing a better job of that stuff now.
I wanted to ask about a few of your guys, more so about, you know, what kind of people they are off the court. You know, when I write my article, I'll rhyme off their stats and those kind of things. But, you know, Dante Carruthers is a 6'1 guard that was the MAC Defensive Player of the Year. How does a 6'1 guy win Defensive Player of the Year?
Yeah, usually that goes to a big. That's a big rim protector, shot blocker. And there's one like that in the league, James Thompson. So for him to win it, you know, over a kid like James, I think just speaks to how hard he plays. I mean, he came in, he was the leading scorer in the state of New York his senior year for high school basketball. So he came in as a scorer, but I think his scoring didn't immediately translate to Division I. I mean, he had sat a year, so I think his rhythm was a little off because he had broke his foot. So he played the 1 year at Duke and was a decent scorer, too. He averaged almost 10 from Midland. But I think you realize if he's going to get on the floor, he had to guard. and he really took it to heart, and he just started locking off. And we got really good guards in this league, too. So when you go through, you know, like Thomas Wilder, the two kids that Central Michigan had, when you know, every game you're seeing a pretty good guard, it's kind of a guards league here. And he did an unbelievable job just making life, you know, he made life as difficult as you can possibly make it for those guys 40 minutes when he was out there. So I think the coaches recognize it, the other players recognize it, and he earned it. He's a tough kid, and he gets up in there. I mean, he's done a pretty good job this year, too, so far.
So Nick Perkins, another guy, you know, Max, six man of the year and returns this year. Tell me a little bit about him and what makes him a special player.
I think he's one of the ones that's benefited the most from the offseason kind of mental mindset, how you approach the game, how you approach practice. He's always been really talented, but, you know, lets his emotions get the best of him at times. He's doing a much better job being really focused and trying to be a leader. And he's also, his body's got, he takes the weight room really serious, and he looks great. He's not taking forced threes anymore. He's just taking open ones. I don't know what he's at right now. He's going into the last game, he was shooting 45% from three, though. So, you know, his threes are open, good looks from three, and he's proven he can shoot it. I've always known he could shoot it. It was just more of a shot selection deal with him, and now he's taking really good shots, and the percentages are proving it.
Nate, I live in Canada. I'm up here in the Toronto area, and I know you've spent most of your life like in Wisconsin and Michigan, and you know it takes a certain kind of guy to be able to survive in the winters in places like Buffalo and Wisconsin. You ever have any stories of players that like had never seen snow before, or perhaps didn't know how to deal with the weather in Buffalo or Wisconsin?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, if you look at our roster, we got a lot. Are you from Toronto originally?
Yeah, born and raised. Yeah.
All right. What part of Toronto are you from?
Well, I'm born and raised in Scarborough, which is the East End, and I now live out in Pickering, which is it's about a 35 minute drive from downtown Toronto. But I work in downtown Toronto though.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Toronto's a great city. Me and my wife went up there a few weeks ago. It's like having New York City like an hour and 15, hour and a half away from Buffalo. So I love it. I mean, if you look at our roster, though, like we got a lot of Southern kids. Like, I mean, we've got a couple from North Carolina, one from South Carolina.
Like Florida. That's why I was asking. Yeah.
So, like, yeah, I mean, I think now the ones in South Carolina said they see snow occasionally. I came in this year when we got the first snow because I got three little girls, too. So, like, two youngest ones are 8 and 5. Man, they see the first snow, and it's like Christmas morning, they're running all over the house. It's snowing. We want to get the sleds out. So I came in that day and asked our guys, Devontae Jordan's mother was up here. He's the one from Cocoa, Florida, like down by Cocoa Beach. So I don't know if any of them saw it for the first time, but yeah, they get all bundled up. It's funny because I, like you said, I grew up in Wisconsin, lived in Detroit for 11 years. I've been in the cold my whole life. I'll come in with like a windbreaker on, like, you know, like not much of a coat. Like, it ain't that big a deal. Some of these guys are bundled up in like winter parka with their hoodie on under the parka with hats and gloves. And like, I'm like, it ain't even bad yet. Like, so they survive it though. And it hasn't hurt us in recruiting really at all. The one thing I tell kids early, like when I first talk to them, like if they're from the South, I'll just come out and address it right away. I'll be like, listen, you know, it's the same temperature in Buffalo in the gym in January as it is in Miami in the gym in January. So you got to let me know up front if it's going to bother you what the outside temperature is, because we got a bunch of gym rats on our team that are spending, you know, I said the good thing about basketball season is it's during the winter and our guys spend their whole time in the gym. So if you're worried about what the weather is outside because you're not planning on being in the gym, like just let me know up front if that's going to be an issue. You know, and we'll know you're probably not our type of player. So, of course, they all answer it. They want to tell you they're gym rats. So, no, coach, that's not going to bother me. I don't care. I'm in the gym all the time, coach. I said, all right, that's good. I just wanted to make sure we got that out of the way right up front.
So, you said you were up here with your wife and that. Were you up here recruiting or just kind of like a weekend away?
Nah, we just went up there. We recruit up there a little bit, but
I noticed you didn't have any Canadians, which is, you know, for Buffalo, that's surprising, you know?
It is. My first year, we had went to nothing within 1 year. So if they're there, I'll tell you what, though. Here's the deal with Canada. Canada went from under-recruited to over-recruited in a hurry. They, like, it, for a while it was under-recruited. Then all of a sudden they get two first-round picks back-to-back, you know, Anthony Bennett and Wiggins. Now everybody's trying to find the next gym in Canada. You know, and like all the under-the-radar kids are now over. It's like almost Toronto's become like New York City. Like it gets over-recruited because everybody needs to get up in Toronto and find the next Wiggins. You know, all the, and it's good. You know, Boucher came out of Oregon's done a really good job, and they got, you know, Mike Mininger there. But, I mean, if they're there and we've got a relationship with a guy and we can get a guy that we feel like is, but I don't want to just take Canadians just because we're the closest good school to Canada either. So if it presents itself to recruit them, like we recruit them, we just haven't, we felt like we've gotten better kids elsewhere in the U.S. and that's what we've gone with.
You know, you mentioned your wife in that, and just, you know, obviously I read that, you know, she's been battling some health issues. Can you give us an update on how she's doing?
Yeah, she gets the CAT scans every, what is it? I think it's every 6 months now. She the last one was good. We had it maybe a month or so ago. So far, I mean, it'll be 2 years this coming spring. So it's been just over a year and a half since her bone marrow transplant. So she would have been going through her first kind of like, she did 6 rounds of chemo. So 2 years ago at this time, she would have been going in for her first, you know, of those 6 rounds of chemo. So it's good. You know, it's been almost 2 years now. We just, you know, we can get to about year three. That's when they say it'll be, you never want to say you're in the clip of this thing because it's a scary disease, but you can get 3 years out without it coming back, like then your odds are much better. So right now everything's good. God's been great. She's got her hair back. She's starting to feel a lot better. She went on the Cayman Islands trip and took the family down there. She had a great time. So we're praising God for what he's done so far. She's still around and she's doing great. And hopefully it never comes back again.
That's awesome. That's good to hear. You know, aside from the wife, I read, you know, three daughters and a wife. Can you talk about the adjustments you have to make before you walk through that front door each night after, you know, being in the gym with 20, 25 dudes all day?
Yeah, if you address the school issues the same way you address the rebounding issues, you're going to have a bunch of crying little girls on your hands. So, yeah. You gotta tone it down a little bit. You gotta put the phone up. They notice when Daddy's on the phone recruiting, so you gotta kind of put the phone away for a couple hours, help him with some homework. I was a math teacher for 15 years, so I gotta make sure I don't get too frustrated with their math skills. You try to have a little more patience with them at home than you do with the players sometimes. Sometimes it's hard, but they're cute. They're cuties. I love them to death. They provide a little dose of real life reality. I mean, we got to win and lose. And I mean, every game you play, there's a winner and a loser here. And if you lose too many, you don't have a job. So there's definitely a stress level with this job. But at the end of the day, the girls are a whole lot more important than winning or losing the basketball games.
Absolutely. You know, Nate, you and I are close in age, and I grew up watching Bobby Hurley and those great Duke teams. You talk about some of the things you learned working with Bobby for a few years.
Yeah, see, I did the same thing. I grew up. I remember where I was when Christian Laettner hit the shot in Kentucky, and
so do I. Yeah,
that might be the best college game I've still ever seen. I mean, so it's like one of those deals. Like, grew up kind of a huge basketball fan, watching him. Then, you know, I got to know him and his brother. I knew him a little bit when he was at Wagner, but then I really got to know them guys well, and they recruited my kid UC. So then the opportunity presents itself. You know, he interviews me for the job. He offers me the job. And I toyed with, you know, when I first got the high school job, I would have probably taken any Division I job in the country anywhere. But then I as you get a little bit older, you got a family, you start to realize that the Division I jobs ain't. So some of those guys are moving every 2 years with a family. That's not what I wanted to do. So I kind of got to the point where I told Bobby this in the interview. Like, I was to the point where, like, look, I'd be happy being a high school coach like Bob Senior in just build like a great program at Romulus and that. But when you get an opportunity to work for a guy like Bobby Hurley with as big a name as he had and his career and his passion for basketball and his pedigree with his dad, his coaching background, that was too good of an opportunity to pass up. I told him in the interview, like, look, if we do this, like, we can't fail at this. I'm not leaving the program I built at Romulus to come. You know, I think that kind of hit him, like, same deal. Like, he's, like, we got to make this work. Like, we got to get there. We got to win. So, I'll tell you what, he's a little bit, like, I love him to die. I just talked to him yesterday for, like, 20 minutes. I will always appreciate the opportunity he gave me. But he's built a little bit different than you and I are built. Like, he probably comes from his dad, and he's probably a little bit, you know, his brother's a little bit the same way. I talked to EC, who plays for his brother. Like, he doesn't handle losing. He's not a very good loser, which it's not necessarily a bad thing, but life is hell around the program when you're losing, and he's the head coach, and, like, you figure out in a hurry, whether you're the assistant coach, the player, whatever, you better figure out how to get win, because it ain't going to be very pleasant if you're not, and he's like the ultra competitor. Like, you can sit there and talk to him about how to talk to the refs and doing this and that. Man, when the ball goes up and you're keeping score, you know, that stuff may as well go out the window. If there's a score being kept and there's competition in it, he's doing whatever he possibly can, and he competes super hard. But it was good for me to work for him. I wasn't a point guard. I played in college. I played Division III. I didn't play at his level. But just some of the stuff that he teaches the point guards, I mean, he's really good working with the guards. I think that helped my coaching career, you know, a lot. And then just different mentality. I mean, he played at the highest level, just how to deal with some of the players, like rest times after games, pushing them here. But he was good. He's good with the players. I learned a lot from him. I owe him my Division I career for him giving me a shot at this thing to start. And we, you know, like I said, I still talk to him quite a bit.
Yeah, you got a pretty mature roster. I think it's 80 or 13 guys are upperclassmen, and you seem set up for a pretty good run here in the next year or two. What's the ceiling for this group of guys?
Yeah, I mean, we are mature, but we only got one senior, and he's not playing right now. He doesn't get eligible till after first semester. Hopefully he's eligible by that Syracuse game. That's Wes Clark that played for me in high school. So I think we're set up to I think we can be really good this year. I think we're turning in the right direction. I love our group of guys, and you can never take anything for granted. Like, I mean, even when Hurley was a coach here, we thought year three was going to be our big year, and then we exploded in year two, and he ended up leaving after 2 years. But I think if, you know, based on what we have, we've only had one senior, like next year we got a chance to be really, really special. And we're trying to set that non-conference schedule up in such a way that we know we're going to be, our recruiting class is really good to go with these guys we got. So I think our depth's going to be really good. And all these guys will be, you know, we'll have a bunch of seniors next year. I mean, you look at who we're starting right now, and it's bunch of juniors. I mean, like Carruthers, Massenburg, Perkins, Jeremy Harris, Nick Perkins are all juniors. You know, Devontae Jordan and then Montel McRae. Devontae Jordan's a sophomore. He's the only non-junior that started. So, you know, we're going to have a bunch of seniors next year and then some really talented incoming guys to work in with them. And I think we got a chance to be pretty special over the next couple of years.